Kick it now. Kick it now. Don't gotta be cool to kick it. Hello. Are we live? Are we live? Hello? Is this thing on?
Oh, yeah. Oh, hey, what? Since our bit rate's a little low.
Low for 1440p?
Yeah.
Nah, it's probably just kicking it up. That's fine. Hello. Hello. Hello, internet. Welcome. Welcome. We're here. We're here for the full nerd. We're here to hang out. I've got all the friends here. We got Alaina. Hello, Alaina. We got Mike Kreider. Do you go Mike by Mike or Michael?
Howdy, howdy. Honestly, there's so many Michaels around everywhere. It's whatever you can remember.
Okay.
I don't mind.
MC. I'll just call you the MC.
I think we've got at least six different Michaels in the company chat at any given day.
That's why I'll just start calling the MC Hammer. I like it. That's what I like.
I've been called worse.
and Willis.
Hey, yo.
He's a little tired, but we're going to keep him up.
I'm a little groggy. Just came back from Vegas. But
Vegas.
What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas.
Oh, snap. Nope. Don't ask him about it.
But you bring the hangover with you.
Actually, it's not the hangover. It's I got a huge food coma because all the buffets are out there, you know?
That too, yeah.
Well, so we are live, but I had to... Willis went to a buffet, and I asked. I was like, "Oh, did they have oxtail there?" Because I remember that CES 2020
that
you and Gordon were just like, "Oxtail." And I was like, "What oxtail?"
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
I mean, for what you're getting, and that's a high value item. You want to go for the high value items in the buffet. Don't load up on bread. It's a bad strategy.
Yes, exactly.
If you want bread, don't go to a buffet. I'm not saying you can't have the bread. Just don't do it there.
Aim for the seafood. Aim for the prime ribs. Just go for the, you know, the good stuff.
And I didn't realize there was a min-max guide for Vegas buffets.
Just hang out with us a little longer. We'll walk you through it.
Well, spoilers, it didn't have oxtail, right?
No, sadly. So,
yeah.
Sadly.
It's a bummer, but you know, maybe next time, maybe for CES, we'll get some. So wait, where can you go to just get oxtail? Is it can you get that at any Chinese restaurant?
Any Chinese, Korean restaurants will have oxtails.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Is it prepared differently or something? Because like of all the parts of an ox that I could eat, the tail is definitely not in like the top 20 that I would think of.
Yeah, it can. I mean, usually for both cuisines that I've had, Chinese and Korean, they're both braised oxtails, which is delicious.
I don't think it's literally an ox's tail.
No, it's like the...
Oh.
I think it's a reference to like some part of the, like a cow. Like originally it meant that, but it's kind of morphed over time.
Okay,
yes.
Well, that's very misleading, because like if you get a plate of brisket, it's actual the brisket part of the cow, like the fleshy part underneath the neck.
According to Wikipedia, oxtail is the culinary name for the tail of cattle. While the word once meant only the tail of an ox, today it can also refer to the tails of other cattle.
Oh, so it is a tail. It just isn't always an ox.
Correct.
Okay.
I mean, an ox is pretty close to a cow, no matter what you call it. So.
Yeah. There you go. Well, we're not. We always start off on food, and we always end on food.
That's
how we do it here. Well, I mean, Thanksgiving was just around the corner. I hope it was fulfilling for everyone's stomachs, even you on the in watching the chat. Hello. And yeah, I'm ready to kick this off. I feel like a little low energy today, but you know, we'll get it going. PC World Foodcast. Yeah. There we go.
There you go.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. So we're talking about pre-RDNA GPUs getting their jersey into a nice little shadow box and put up on the wall. We got 8000G, which is hopefully coming out of the shadows maybe sometime soon. We got some leaks. And then Alaina's yearly tradition of a $500.
Yeah.
Cyber Monday. Is it ever a Black Friday or is it always just Cyber Monday? I always forget.
No, it started as Black Friday and then it actually lasted long enough for yesterday to still be a thing. So that's actually a newish trend for the 7 years I've been writing about this.
Got it.
So
I like it. Didn't one of the years you actually bought the stuff and then we built it?
I did.
Because
everyone kept saying you should actually build it. Put your money where your mouth is. And so I think it was 2018 or 20. No, wait. It was during the pandemic, so I think it was 2020 that we did it.
We should. I like it. All right, cool. Anyway,
One quick question.
Yes.
I am seeing reports in the chat still about buffering. Do we want to address that before we get started?
Are we getting any?
Stream health is healthy right now.
Are you seeing any drops on OBS?
OBS, no.
No. Huh. I would say restart the tab. Hopefully it's good.
Refresh. Okay. Right. Yeah.
Looks like we're getting reports
cool.
that it's fine.
And we got an ad read by the one and only Alaina.
Are we doing this?
Yeah. So
okay.
You'll do the ad read. I'll do the intro. Let me bring the intro back so I can remember what to say so I don't mess it up. Okay. Okay. All right. Cool. Let's do it.
All right. This episode of The Full Nerd is sponsored by Asus. On December 3rd, the company will be hosting PC DIY Day, a celebration of all things PC building and modding. The festivities kick off at 11 a.m. Pacific at Asus's U.S. headquarters in Fremont, California, with guest appearances by GGF Events, Hippotech, and even PC World's own Adam Patrick Murray. Click on the link in the description to pick up tickets for this event or tune into the live stream.
In this episode of The Full Nerd, we talk about AMD retiring legends, APU leaks, and Alaina's $500 Cyber Monday PC. Nice and smooth. Welcome to episode 281 of The Full Nerd, PC World's premier podcast about PC hardware. I am your fill-in host for this episode, Adam Patrick Murray. On the line, I have two of my coworkers. First up, we have Alaina Yee. Hello, Alaina.
Hi, everybody.
Welcome back to the show. And welcoming back to the show is Mike Kreider, or MC. MC is what I'm going to start calling you.
DJ MC.
Yeah.
Howdy, howdy.
DJ MC. Good to have you back, Mike. And on the verticals and horizontals is a very Vegas-fied Willis Lye.
This is the Vegas pony right here.
you're riding the Vegas pony all the way
Vegas
home.
Pony, exactly.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. Hello, internet. I'm a little groggy. Still have food coma. Not hangover, but food coma, definitely.
I mean, it's a hangover. It's just a different kind of hangover. Yeah. Also, you know, maybe your pocket is a lot lighter coming back.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Because it's so expensive.
And I know he doesn't like that. So... let's start off. We got some fun news episodes. The last couple episodes have been we've had guests on, so we've kind of missed a little bit of the stuff going on in the news, so we wanted to kind of revisit. The first up, let's talk about AMD taking the pre-RDNA GPUs and just slowly pushing them off into the sunset. Just being like, oh, you know what, you had a good life, just, you know, let's just keep going. Mike, you wrote an article quickly kind of summarizing this stuff. So tell us the TLDR. What's going on here?
I mean, there isn't too much to say. It's some of the older cards of the RX 400 and RX 500 series on the consumer side, and they're just reaching the end of their real practical utility when it comes to those very big, heavy updates. They're still going to get, you know, core operating updates and security updates if they should need them. But other than that, they won't be, you know, updated in the important and very frequent AMD adrenaline bumps that we see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I had a link to the Anantech article, and that's what you had linked out to, which I think it was Ryan Smith over here. Let me double check. He did, yes, Ryan Smith did get a quote from AMD. I just want to read it real quick here to set the tone. Quote, the AMD Polaris and Vega graphics architecture are mature, stable, and performant, and don't benefit as much from regular software tuning. Going forward, AMD is providing critical updates for Polaris and Vega-based products via a separate driver package, including important security and functionality updates as available. The committed support is greater than for products AMD categorizes as legacy, and gamers can still enjoy their favorite games on Polaris and Vega-based products. Now, one of the things that Ryan gets into the article is that there's a difference for AMD, at least, between legacy and things that are just not getting as frequently updated. So, you know, however you want to categorize this, the idea is that, hey, you know what? It's stable. It's mature. There's not much more that we can do going forward. So it will continue to get driver updates for, you know, some unforeseeable future as of right now, but it's mostly around critical fixes and things like that. I think the first one that kind of comes to my mind is that that's the RX 580. I mean, we talked about the RX 580 for a long time as being like, oh man, I mean, what was the cheapest? It was like $100, right? You could get an RX 580 for like $100 or $120 or something.
That was the 570.
Oh, okay.
That you could get almost that low.
But it was like, for me, like I always look back and maybe Alaina, I'm misremembering this, but I always think of like the RX 580 being the last great, you know, close to $100 GPU that you could get.
It was a $200 card.
Oh, okay.
Right? Like, we really haven't seen a card like that at that price for a while. So I think it came out either at, I think it came out at like a 200, 250. So the amount of performance you got for that price was really good at the time. Mm. And then we had the pandemic being the pandemic and nobody could get cards. And so even though by that time, because this card came out like in 2016. So this card's 7 years old now, 580s at least, I think.
Yeah.
And so I think around the pandemic, people were kind of expecting it to just quietly go off to a well-deserved retirement. And it actually kind of came back because nobody could afford the more modern cards. And so that's what people ended up either sticking with or buying used, or even I think there was some stock left so that people were buying it new. And yeah. And even now to this day, so to be clear, this is not the scene at the end of Lord of the Rings where they're getting into the boats, riding off.
Spoilers.
They're like discussing. Sorry, it's the boat. Like everyone knows the story now.
Spoilers.
Sorry. I'm sorry.
I'm just kidding.
I'm not really sorry. But anyway, they're discussing the idea of getting into the boats. They haven't reached it yet. So, I mean, if we get 8 years, 9 years out of these cards, like that's pretty fantastic. It's had quite a run. And I want to note, I want to put on the record here, mm-hmm. I nominated this card, the 480/580, for the Hall of Fame.
Okay, I was trying to
well before this.
I was trying to go back and look, and I was like, crap, did we actually put this in the Hall of Fame or not?
We did not put it in the Hall of Fame. Everybody shot me down because I said it was too soon. And so on the one hand, I am so proud of this. I'm so proud of this this pick of mine that it's lasted this long. But also, according to these rules, I still can't put it forth again until it's properly given its send off.
I think, I mean, come on, we were trying to gun for the 1080 Ti. We got so, you know, we keep getting so close, but yeah, the argument is like, oh, it's still relevant, you know. But I would say in some ways it's less relevant. But yeah, no, I mean, the 480 is, I feel, here we go. Dion Spates calls it a legendary card. I definitely think it's one of those and deserves to be in the Hall of Fame. But I do want to do a quick little note. We didn't have a Hall of Fame this year for reasons. Obviously, it's important to have Gordon there. So, you know, with him on medical leave, didn't feel right to have an all Hall of Fame episode. But hopefully, you know, next year we can get back to it. Because, yeah, things like the 480 need to get in there. Looking over the actual parts, too, you know, obviously there's things like the Vega 64, which, you know, had its own stuff. The Radeon 7, which we have on our setback here. You can't see it right now. Beautiful card. I still look at that and be like, man, I just love the look of the Radeon 7. But I was reminded, I was like, oh, crap, this also means Ryzen 5000G APUs, which we'll talk about APUs a little bit in the next segment. But like, I think, I mean, the 580 is definitely still relevant. Yeah, I feel like those other cards like the Vega 64 and Radeon 7 were a little less rare. I'm sure there's not that many people using those cards out there anymore. But for APUs, I'm like, oh, wow. I feel like there's a lot of people who got in on that APU action. Like, do you think that's kind of like when you look at all the market of these cards that are getting kind of, you know, slowly pushed off into the sunset, that APUs are the ones that sold the most?
Do you mean like we think that APU integrated graphics are getting so good that we don't really need cards down at this
No, I mean like out of all these cards, like so you have 580, you know, Vega 64, Radeon 7 APUs, and these Ryzen 5000 APUs. Well, I guess it's not only the Ryzen 5000, but all the Ryzen APUs. I'll just call it that. Of this category, the APUs are probably the ones that sold the most. Like just mass market.
I don't have that data in front of me, unfortunately. So I don't know. Because like, are we talking about DIY segment versus mainstream versus all of it? Because I feel like those are very different conversations to be having, right?
True. Well, I mean, I guess the point I'm really trying to make is like the APUs like continue to be relevant for now.
for now.
Well, you know, we got the next segment. That if you got in on a Ryzen 5000G part, do you think people should be worried who are using those cards or the 580 to be like, oh crap, you know what? It's going to be meaningless. I just throw it away now.
No, because an APU, the benefit of having an APU is that if you don't have a discrete graphics card, you can just slap one in at any time if you really want to. At that point, you just have a CPU with really good integrated graphics on the side, right? That's what we promoted.
Anyway.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
For desktops, anyway, I imagine a huge part of these APU sales are also laptops,
or like mini PCs, that kind of stuff too.
Yeah, I mean, in that case, I feel like if you're buying a mini PC, you're not really buying it for gaming so much. So the integrated graphics part is not going to be as relevant in terms of gaming. I think for laptops, kind of a similar story. That's just my opinion, obviously. And then where it's relevant, this question is desktop. And then for the desktop, like we've promoted on the show before, especially in my spoiler alert, earlier Black Friday builds, not this year's, but earlier ones. I mean, that APU, like you're building, as Brad likes to call it, you know, a Fortnite PC for, you know, somebody who doesn't need a lot of firepower, but it'll get the job done and doesn't cost that much. Well, down the road, if they want to play something that's more graphically intense, then assuming that you have a free slot, then you just put in a, maybe one of these RX 580s at a steep discount.
There you go. What do you think history will look back on these Vega and Polaris cards? Like, how do you think we're going to view them? Do you think we're going to still view them as rose-colored saviors as we did, kind of once signaling, oh, you know, a nice low-end option and also kind of a good option during the pandemic? Or do you think as time goes on, it's like, eh, okay, well, you know, we used it as we needed it, but it wasn't that great?
I really wish Brad were here. I feel like that would be a more informed opinion. From my perspective, I think that if the future continues on in this vein where we're really getting cards in the over 500 range, where like that's where most of the innovation is happening, right? Then I think, yeah, it's going to seem very, like we're going to really look back and think of it with like a kind of rosy nostalgia. But I think if we eventually get back to having something like the RX 580 holding that position once again in the 200, maybe with inflation, 300 range, then I think it won't be as romanticized, but I think it'll still have a really strong place in history just because it held that position for so long. It kind of got people through for so long. I don't see a timeline where it suddenly becomes the villain or something to ignore, but that's just
me. You never know, it's the internet.
Yeah.
You know, Mike, what do you think? How are you going to look back on Vega and Polaris?
Well, if the idea was to stay competitive in that, you know, $200 to $300 range, as long as it did, it was very impressive. But unfortunately, we are far beyond that now. I mean, after the pandemic, it is dang hard to get a discrete graphics card for under $300 that will do everything that it did back then at that level of performance that we were looking for. But I would say that all is not lost. The sad thing is that AMD doesn't really seem to want to compete there, and Intel does. I'd say if anybody is looking for, like, hoping to get that kind of incredible power to price ratio, that real can't ignore it kind of value, then I would look for Intel right now has some, not quite at that high performance, but I'm really excited to see what they do with their second generation of ARC cards, especially when it comes to value.
Or you could look at Ryzen 8000G APUs.
Before we transition.
Oh, okay. Stop. Hold the... pump the brakes.
Back it up.
Yeah, back it up. Beep.
Yes, sorry. I did want to put... I did want to add like a little asterisk to my comment, which is the one thing that you could see as a negative in this is... and I think in fairness to mention it, is that this is also a signal of how disinterested companies are, as Mike was pointing out, in kind of pushing this area. And that's kind of disappointing for us sitting on the sidelines and also buying parts, because this is, you could make a similar argument for when Intel was dominating desktop consumer CPUs, right? Where it's like, it's four cores, eight threads again. Like, it's not really pushing. And then suddenly AMD walks in, they're like, boom, here's like a crap ton more cores. What you gonna do about that? And suddenly we just have this like arms race that started, right? We don't see that because no one's paying attention in that space. So that is, I would say, the one negative to this, right? Mm. So on the one hand, great, it had this longevity, but on the other hand, it does signal like, okay, like there's some stagnation going on there. There's a lack of attention. And this is, mild spoiler alert, today I'm just all about the spoilers. This is something that I would like to bring up in one of the
happened
later
at
seconds.
The end of Oppenheimer.
Now do Oppenheimer. No. Now the Barbie movie.
Yeah, yeah. No. So is it that they're not interested, or do you think they actually can't, or maybe they just don't want to play down to the low end because there's just no margins, and it's like, you know what, like. We're not gonna sell these at cost, so you know, we just don't even want to play down to the low end anymore. So I'm sure they're interested. I mean, that is a huge market, right? But it's also not the most lucrative market.
I think the answer is kind of yes to all of those things, right? Because I mean, we're talking about a business, we're talking about professionals.
Yeah.
And so at the end of the day, you have to make your numbers. And so what you're interested in is going to be dictated by that. Right. From that perspective, I'm not necessarily talking like from my perspective, interest is not necessarily like personal interest. You know, I'm absolutely sure there are people on the teams there who would love to pay attention to that segment. But I mean, we all work for companies and there's priorities, right? That you
speak
kind of
for
have
yourself,
to pay
Alaina.
Attention to.
Just kidding. No, we're all. Yeah.
You're like, I don't care about anything.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't have anyone to report to. I can make whatever videos I want.
But as friend of the show Davina says in the chat here, integrated graphics will improve to a point where the low-end GPU makes no sense, which means maybe the Ryzen 8000G can fill in that. So, I mean, we've talked about this before, you know, of APUs kind of coming in and being that new $100 to $200 option for low-end stuff. So, yeah, there's been some recent leaks. Earlier in November, there was leaks about the 8000G series. We actually have some newer leaks. I have a link to the WCCF Tech article. They kind of take, who is it, Hassan, kind of took information from a Persian Tech and PC outlet. I'm going to really butcher this name. Let me try this. Saktof Zarmog. Has not only the specifications of the 8000G Phoenix APU family, but also some benchmarks. So first off, we don't have a slide for it, but there's kind of a big breakdown of supposedly all of the parts that are in this. And it's, you know, actually, I guess the lowest, quote unquote, lowest end part is eight cores. Is that? Four cores, eight threads. It's listed backwards. So we got four cores, eight threads. We got some six core, 12 threads. And actually some eight core, 16 thread parts. You know, these are right Ryzen 8000 parts. We know the awesomeness of the new Ryzen parts, but more importantly, there are some leaks of performance. If you want to show the actual benchmark slide first, this is a slide showing Ryzen 7 5000G versus Ryzen 7 8000G in these supposed benchmarks. Unfortunately, it's not actually showing us real performance. It's just relative performance. So if you take the Ryzen 5000G, put that at 100% and say, oh, okay, how much faster percentage-wise is the 8000G, and you know, what we got, Geekbench is, you know, what, a 40 something percent faster. What else we got on here? 8 to 64 is 100% faster. DaVinci, over 100% faster. Okay, cool. Blender, like approaching 250% faster. So, yeah. Anyway, I mean, I think that comes with just more cores too. So,
yeah. So, I actually, before the show started, and I want to preface this by saying, like, this is a very rough approximation, right? Obviously, different settings, possibly different drivers, but yeah, if people want more real world idea what we're talking about here, so according to this slide, let me just get this back up real quick. Where is this, the game performance? Okay, here we go.
Yeah, so now let's switch over to the game slide.
Yeah, so according to the game slide, if like you take something like Shadow the Tomb Raider DX12 setting, right, it's saying like you get, what, almost double the performance, right?
A little over 100% more, yeah.
Yeah, like about double the performance, roughly. So not knowing what these settings are at all, I was looking at Tom's Hardware's review of the 5700G. Mm-hmm. And so for Shadow of the Tomb Raider, 1080p DX12, lowest settings, the 5700G was getting, on average, about 37.6 frames per second.
Okay.
So that's at 1080p. So this is why I still think of the Ryzen 5000 series, or Ryzen 5000G series, as more of like 720p gaming type graphics. Mm-hmm. So this is suggesting that maybe we're actually seeing like truly playable 1080p performance out of these 8000G parts, but we'll have to wait until we get more discrete benchmarks for that. But to me, that's exciting.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, very caveat, these are leaks. We do not have parts. We don't know actual test results. But I mean, at least the indication is that you're looking at maybe two times the performance of the Ryzen 5000G stuff, which, I mean, yeah, was no slouch. I mean, I think a lot of people would, you know, snub their 720p or 1080p low. Oh, it's not for me. I totally get it. But at the same time, I mean, that's not bad, especially if you're looking at a budget. So
not bad at all, especially like exactly if you're on a budget, if you're playing like esports games that don't require a lot of, you know, graphical firepower from your hardware. Also a really nice option, right? I do think, to me, this proves though that, like, I think a lot of people think that APU integrated graphics are going to replace low end. And I think that might be true for, like, say, like your $75 discrete GPU, where, you know, before in the old days, you'd get like a budget CPU, you get a really budget graphics card. That was my first build. Like, I got like a $60 graphics card because basically I was like, I just need an output to a monitor. Yep. Like, I wasn't looking to play games on it. I just need a signal, right? So this is kind of in that range where it's like, maybe you're buying like a $70, $80, $100 graphics card. You're not trying to do a lot with it, but, you know, maybe just a little bit more that you want from it than just only putting it that signal to a monitor. But I don't think, at least for now, like, I would hope to see this someday, but I don't think for a while we're going to really see something that's going to replace like a solid $150 card, a $200 card. Mm. Like, I think those will always, if you cut down like one of the bigger cards, like, that's always going to be better than what's going to be on an integrated package.
Hmm. Well, the other question I have, and there are no leaks to indicate here, or at least in what I'm seeing in this article, but obviously, moving to AM5, Ryzen 8000, I mean, we're talking about a switch to DDR5, obviously the newer chipsets, things like that. So, since the launch of Ryzen 7000, there has been good bundle deals. Prices have gone down on DDR5, but I still think we're probably at a price premium over where we were with Ryzen 5000. What do you think? Do you think the floor for getting in on an APU is going to be higher? So,
I mean, it's really possible. I mean, the prices all kind of floated up. We've seen the prices kind of been gradually floating up over generation. I think this last one, we didn't see as much budging, but like, you know, like I think maybe one or two chips might get like a tiny increase. A couple like didn't at all, but it hasn't been just holding steady at like a set level. And then everyone keeps talking about inflation. I know the people have said that inflation has been getting better, but I don't think that lowered the floor, right? Like the floor came up on everything. I don't think we're really seeing the floor drop. Like, I don't think we're seeing the floor rise as quickly as it has been, but I don't know if that, if we're going to see an effect where the floor is actually going to start dropping back down itself. And because of that, I'm not particularly hopeful that these are going to come in and replace Ryzen 5000 series APUs at similar price points. I would love to see it, but I also just paid double for a new set of tires than I did last time. So I'm that's very big in my thoughts right now.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess we'll see on the pricing. Once again, we don't know. This isn't official, so we'll kind of see there. But say this does come out at price parity, or maybe to get in on a whole platform doesn't cost too much. I mean, who right now, who would APU buyers be? Mike, I'll toss it to you first. Who do you think this kind of targets? Because I think it was you who mentioned, like, it's not just about gaming. It's also, you know, like a lot of productivity people who just need a display out.
I would say, assuming that this came out tomorrow and we saw, you know, relatively the same prices with adjusted for inflation, it's looking at the same people as it was in the 5000 series. It's looking, hey, here's a good computer that does everything you absolutely need your computer to do. It handles documents, it can surf the web, it can watch videos when your kids come over, and also it can play some games, asterisk. So it can load up Fortnite. Gosh, the way they've done Fortnite in the last year, it can probably do it at 20 frames per second. But it can play Minecraft. It can play, you know, the card game that you want to play with your friends. It can load up that that D&D environment that's online that you want to check out. And at the end of the day, yes, it could technically play the latest Call of Duty, whatever. It's not going to be an ideal situation, but you can try it if you want. It's a place to start. And as Alaina was saying, if you get that in a desktop environment, you can always throw in a card, and it's going to cost a lot more than it did in 2017, but you have that option if you want to. I might keep people keep getting upset at me for drawing to this, but if you're in that space where you just need a computer, but you want games, I still think consoles are kind of the way to go. If you can buy a console at the same price of a new card and you just want that experience, you're not counting frames and you're not insisting on 4K resolution, yeah, that's still the way most people are looking.
Speak for yourself, MC.
I do.
Alaina, who do you think these Ryzen 8000G APUs, if they play out the way that these are talked about, who do you think they're for?
I think that it's kind of a squirrely answer, I know, but I would say that my opinion depends on what price they come out at. Mm-hmm. Right. So, I mean, they sound great on paper, like very exciting to see, you know, gaming performance jump by, you know, jump enough that you're getting double the performance, supposedly. Right. But if that also comes with a, I don't know, 30% price increase, then it makes you wonder at that point, like, well, is it worth it? You know, like, and then is it worth it relative to how much discrete graphics cards are at the time? And, you know, CPUs with just more standard integrated graphics, right? So, I mean, I guess it's kind of a cop-out answer, but for me, it is, I do feel like if it's like the worst case scenario and everything is just inflating in price, then I think these kind of stay as sort of a almost more niche kind of purchase, right? Like certain use cases where you don't really need a discrete graphics card, but you could use a little bit more than what you get from more standard integrated graphics. And the price is like not super great, but it's still cheaper than everything else because your options are graphics cards that are two generations old, or it's going to cost you $800. So then you bite the bullet, right? But if we're in a timeline where these are priced more comparably to what we're seeing now, the motherboard prices aren't bad, Then I could see myself recommending this more often to people who are just getting into PC gaming. They don't want to spend a lot on it. They kind of want to see what it's like. The games they play aren't that graphically punishing. You know, they don't mind something that maybe is like not even higher tier console level gaming worthy. Like you're talking more like an Xbox Series S type experience, you know, which in theory actually does 1440p. So that's a whole other, like Mike was saying, as much as hate that people put on consoles, if you really just want to play games at certain resolutions, they get that job done. Yeah. They really do.
I do think one other glory that we saw in AM4 and hopefully we'll continue to see in AM5 is the idea is that, you know, maybe you can get in on the AM5 platform, you know, later be able to upgrade the CPU, throw in a discrete GPU, you know, so yeah. That at least there's upgrade options where there wouldn't be in a console, things like that. We do have a $10 super chat from front of the show VC Jester, renamed to Jester the Pester.
Thank you.
Which, yeah, works. $10, thank you so much. I think people most interested in integrated graphics are the workers who don't get to pick their office computer. They want to know what games they can play during break. Good point. Yeah, I mean, we talked about this, like, yeah, this could be a work situation. Maybe it's this is just a computer that you ended up getting because of work. And you're like, oh, you know what, actually, you know what, I can play a little bit of gaming on the side. Okay, cool. A little bonus.
Solitaire.
Let me give you a theoretical here, just because it's fresh in my mind.
Please.
We were looking at a lot of the Black Friday deals, and there's one model that always seems to show up almost all year round, and it's the, I think it's the Acer Nitro 5 is a 15-inch gaming laptop. You can almost always find one at around $700 to $800 on Amazon. It's frequently their best-selling laptop. And usually you get like a mid-range i5 or i7, and then you get, this year I think they were doing RTX 3050s and 3070s at around the $700 to $800 level. Mm. Now let's say you could go with a theoretical Ryzen 7 8000G, and you could approach that level of performance at something, gosh, if I was having to guess, I'd say that laptop would probably cost you $1,000 to $1,200 with a brand new mid-range to high-end APU. Which one do you go for? Do you go for the big, chunky gaming laptop that can get this done, or you go for the sleek laptop that won't tear out your shoulder at the end of the day carrying it all over campus?
I mean, I think it's also a different market too. Like I definitely see laptop buyers different than people who want to build or get into a desktop or maybe have a desktop for work. I think the other thing too that it keeps in my mind, and it's not one-to-one, but also handhelds, you know, like obviously there's great APU performance on handhelds. This is kind of, you know, catching up to that on the desktop, which is why I'm like, oh yeah, if it can do 720p, that's awesome. I do that all the time on Steam Deck. But yeah, I think it's just a different audience too at that point. Like people who are like the idea of upgrading and having a separate, you know, build process and a chip that they can throw in versus a laptop. Alaina, what do you think? Would you recommend, if somebody came to you and was like, oh, you know what, I only got X amount of money to build something, would you ever recommend to them, oh, hey, you know what, you should just get a laptop instead?
So I feel like maybe the question here has like a couple different bands to it, right? Mm-hmm. So the leaks about the 8000G series specifically are about desktop chips.
Yeah,
so that's one thing, right? So you're not going to see these, at least based on these rumors, we're not going to be seeing them in laptops based on this particular information. So that's one thing.
It is a mobile part though. So it's just kind of catching up. Cause I think they say, what is it? It's supposed to be Radeon 740M, 760M and 780M.
Sorry, maybe I'm looking at a different article than you are. So, like, the one I'm looking at is, like, focused on the desktop part.
Oh, no. These APUs are those M parts, according to these leaks.
Hmm.
So, it's essentially just catching up, or, you know, like, to the desktop, what's already been available in laptop kind of stuff. But I think it's also, like, just a matter of who it's for.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. This is kind of why the reason I brought this up, because for me, this sorting out this question is kind of predicated on that.
Mm-hmm.
So let me actually look at the article you're looking at, because I'm looking at
Sorry, I was looking at WCCF Tech. At the bottom, it has the English translation of the the earlier slide. Yeah, no. One other point, real quick. They're speaking of factors that you're buying into. Like there was talk on, can't remember which podcast I was listening to. They're like, oh, you know, would you rather get the Steam Deck, the OLED Steam Deck, or you know, maybe you should just pay a little bit more and get a gaming laptop that you could, you know, get more performance out of. And I'm like, I mean, yeah, theoretically, but like that's a completely different form factor. Like I can't, you know, sure, maybe if I spend $100 more, I can get twice the performance on a gaming laptop that I can on a Steam Deck. But also, I'm not holding a laptop the same way I'm holding a Steam Deck. You know what I mean? Like it's just not in my mind.
You can't take notes on it in class.
Yeah. In my mind, those aren't necessarily the same kind of thing, because if you're looking for a handheld, you're looking for that handheld form factor. You know. So, yeah.
Okay. I don't know. I think maybe I'm still not completely off of long weekend brain, but from what I'm interpreting from these articles, that the focus and like these benchmarks are focused on the desktop experience. So for me, that makes it a separate question. Like, so I'm looking at a desktop experience versus laptop experience, and then which laptop experience, is it the more budget one or is it a more mid-range, solidly mid-range one? And I think to answer this question in kind of a general way, I think that it's really dependent on what you want out of your system. So obviously desktop's always going to be a more upgradable experience, especially if you start with an APU, because then you have basically just left that PCIe slot open and you can fill it with whatever you want down the road. And you can just wait and wait and wait for it, which is why we recommended that during the pandemic, when it was just so hard to get a good graphics card at a decent price. Laptop, again, like I know a lot of people who choose that because they want to have that portability. They don't care about the upgrading down the road. They want just to be able to play in a hotel room, play at their friend's house, play, you know, when they're in the waiting room somewhere, because, you know, for whatever reason, they're just out of the house a lot.
Which is valid. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. Once again, I think it just depends on your use case kind of thing. Either way, I'm excited. The last note I kind of have on this is like, right now we're on Ryzen 7000. So if these are called 8000G, are the APUs going to come out before a Ryzen 8000 desktop, like a non-APU part? Or does that also signal that Ryzen 8000 is coming soon too?
I think Ryzen 8000 is coming soon. Yeah. The rumor, the site that I looked at, think that these APU chips are supposed to be coming out soon, so like within the next few months. So we may see more about this officially at CES, perhaps.
Which, yeah. So, but do you think Ryzen 8000 would launch with APU parts only, or would it be, hey, we have Ryzen 8000, you know, full refresh and also APU, boom, both at the same time?
I, at this point, with how weird things have been over the last year, I mean, the fact that we saw 14th gen refresh come out, like where it was like, wah, wah, after like, all, like still decent chips, right? But like after like, what, three cycles at least of just chips being like, I'm going to clock you in the chin, I'm going to clock you back in the chin. Like, and it's just like, oh, well, I showed up to the arena and everyone was like, polite clapping, right? Like, you know, it's just like, it was kind of anticlimactic, honestly, after how fierce the struggle has been. And to me, that's kind of a signal that maybe we are, maybe not, we should not be expecting it to always be like the opening to another WWE match.
I mean, I think the other way to phrase this too is a friend of the show, Tim Lau, in the chat put it kind of, you know, the way they're seeing it and the, kind of the way I see it is Ryzen 8000G, as leaked as of right now, is Ryzen 7000 desktop compute with RDNA 3 mobile graphics. So in my mind, I'm like, okay, well, why would you not just call that 7000G? Like, why call it? I mean, once again, we don't know. Maybe it will come out 7000G, but as of right now, the leaks are saying 8000G. So, I don't know.
Maybe they're going to 9,000 finally. They're not even going to do 8,000. They're just going to go for the next like architecture, next generation architecture. They're just going to go straight to 9,000. Maybe that's what it's really saying.
Yeah, so 8,000G is only APUs, and the actual next refresh is 9,000. All right, it's over 9,000.
I would be surprised. 8's a good number in Chinese cultures. Good to know.
Okay, yeah.
We'll see.
Good question. I like it. I like it. You know what else we're going to see before we get to the next topic? We got to pause and thank our sponsor for the show, Asus. They have a, if you didn't hear the ad reach at the beginning by the one Alaina Yee, Asus is having a PC DIY day this Sunday. What was the date? The 3rd.
December 3rd.
December 3rd, down at the Fremont office. You can get tickets. There's a link in the description. Go over, get some tickets. They're going to have a ton of events going on there, including like a, I think it's a Valorant tournament or something like that. They're going to have some builds, some mods, things like that. And yeah, there will be some guests on hand. I will be there as a guest, just kind of hanging out and celebrating all things PC. So yeah, and then they're going to be doing a live stream. I will show up on a couple of segments in the live stream as a guest. And yeah, should be all around a good time. So if you're in the Bay Area or you want to fly out just for this event, get some tickets. PC DIY Day. Yes, Alaina?
I have a question for you. When can we expect to see you? Like, I mean, of course, in an ideal world, everyone would have enough free time just to be on the stream all day waiting for you. but maybe it would be easier for people if they knew a rough idea when to tune in for you.
Great question. The stream kicks off right now, as I believe, at 11 a.m. Pacific. But it's going to be starting with a build with a GCF event. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I say that right? GCF events?
The GGF?
GGF, I'm sorry. And I'm blanking on his name right now. He did a build during LTX as well. So I think they're starting with that build. I might pop in and just kind of marvel at hard tubing. Hopefully not break anything. But yeah, no, I believe, if I remember the schedule off the top of my head, I'll have to double check. I will post about this on Discord. So if you're interested, that we're Hippiotech, which I talked to at LTX, is actually going to do a keyboard build with me because I've never built a custom keyboard. So I'm excited to do that. I believe that's going to happen at 1 p.m. Pacific. So as of right now, that's how I believe I'm going to be appearing on the streams. But if you're local, you know, I'll be obviously there. So come say hi. Should be a good time. So.
Are you signing T-shirts if they show up with them?
I mean, I will sign almost anything.
Sign GPUs.
I like how you put that little almost
anything. I was thinking. I was like, hey, if somebody came up to me with a slice of pizza, would I sign a slice of pizza? Yes, I would. That would fall in my anything. But almost.
What a wonderfully neutral example.
Yeah.
Hey Adam, sign my cat.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I don't, would I sign a cat? I don't know if I'd sign a cat.
Katie probably would not be happy.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely pet the cat. Anyway, thank you for Asus for sponsoring this. PC DIY Day, check it out, coming out on the 3rd. But now, let's move over to the main segment, the soup du jour of the day. Actually, I guess that's... I'm doubling up because soup du jour means of the soup of the day, right? So it's like ATM machine soup du jour of the day. Alaina, you have this article came out yesterday. It's linked to in the description. Go check it out. It's your $500 Cyber Monday PC. For those who don't know, please give us a little bit of a backstory of this article because you've been doing this for years.
I have. I started it in 2016 when I joined the PC World staff. Because if you don't really know me, I really enjoy bargain hunting and like min-maxing on deals. And so
we didn't know that.
I mean, there's hopefully I know. People tuning in for the first time.
Well, welcome. If you didn't know, now you know.
Now you know because I was sitting at home eating my turkey on Thanksgiving Day and I was like, I'm seeing some pretty good deals for hardware. I wonder what the cheapest build I can do with Black Friday deals is, because I know I could roll this together into something pretty good and it would be a lot less than the rest of the year. Let's see what I can do. So for the first few years, I was very excited about doing like the absolute lowest build possible, just almost like as a temperature read on like how the industry was doing, like how, I guess, basically the economy as well, like the level of competition between the companies, you know, because we saw like wild stuff like the 2700X, Ryzen 2700X for $130 at Micro Center. Do you remember that
eight,
one?
8-core CPU, dang.
Do you remember that one? That was early getting so many cores, and we were still very dazzled by it. Yeah. So getting it for that little during Black Friday was amazing. Right. So I spent a lot of time in that area at first where I was just like, okay, like, what can I do? Can I get it below 350? Can I get it below 300? I think at one point, I think I might have gotten it below 300. And then there's always so many APU builds you can do before you're like, yeah, this is maybe not really helpful or interesting anymore. So last year, I started looking at it more from a more I think realistic perspective, which is like, okay, like, can I do a really good build, like actually a really solid gaming build for 400 or 500? And last year, it turns out that number was you could do a $500 gaming build that would give you 1080p ultra gaming, you know, standard 60 frames per second. So that to me was kind of a coup. Like that said a lot of good things about where we're at in the industry, especially at that point last year after the pandemic, it being all kind of gross. And then this year, I feel like it was really interesting because it was basically like somebody took like a sign that said 2022 and just like crossed out the two and then like slapped a three over it. Because if you look at my builds, like if you look at my builds from 2023 versus 2022, they're almost identical in what you're getting, I feel like.
Which we should show. Go ahead and put on screen the $500 build. If you want to follow along in the article, there's a link in the description. But here's how it breaks down. So why don't you go over the parts list real quick for us?
Yeah. So for this year, there's some upgrades, some small upgrades. So, I mean, we have made some progress, but they're very similar. This year, we got a Ryzen 5 5600 for $130. A ASRock B550 Phantom Gaming motherboard with Wi-Fi, $85. 16 gigs of DDR4 3600 RAM for $35. A Intel, so this is different from last year. This year it was an Intel Arc A750 8GB graphics card for $180. And this one came with a free game.
Ooh.
So you got Assassin's Creed Mirage with it. And I will admit there was some bias in choosing this because, I mean, it was the cheaper card. But also, it's Assassin's Creed. And I don't know why, but I am a huge Assassin's Creed fan. I was like, yep, I'm all over that one. That's great. I love it.
Gotcha.
Storage earlier on Black Friday. So this actually held really well over the weekend. So for the Black Friday version of this, it was the Solidigm P41 512 gigabyte SSD for $27, and then that went out of stock because it sold like gangbusters. And so I found a well-rated MSI 500 gigabyte NVMe SSD, also Gen 4, for $26. However, this one required a mail-in rebate, so it was a little more work.
Okay. Mail-in rebates, I guess I always forget that they still exist. Do you feel like mail-in rebates are kind of going away?
No? They're still around, but they're not nearly as prevalent as they were back in like the aughts, you know, even the early 2010s. I feel like I felt a lot more of them back then to get these kinds of deals. And so, I mean, these are small signs that things have gotten better because... last year, there were more mail-in rebates that you had to deal with. This year, not as many. So that was nice. So this was a simpler way to get a really good deal on
does make
$500
it way
PC.
Yeah. One other side note. Dr. Ian Cutress, a friend of the show, Tech Tech Potato, has corrected me in the past. It's Solidim.
Solidim, okay.
Solidim is the...
Dim.
Yeah.
feel like a DIMM for RAM.
But the power supply, non-modular, I dig it.
It'd make Gordon happy.
Yeah, it would not make Gordon.
So the power supply, obviously some people are going to take some, let's say, umbrage, have some concerns about, because it's not, you know, high on the vaunted tier list for PSUs. But I mean, this is a budget build, y'all. And I do make notes about this in the write-up. I'm pretty thorough about it. Hmm. This, I chose actually a slightly higher wattage. You could have actually gotten a cheaper one, 500 watt one for 35, but I went with 600 watt for 40, just in the thought that, you know, maybe down the road, if somebody wanted to upgrade to a more powerful graphics card, they weren't limited by their power supply so much.
Well, I dig it.
Great deal on a Fantex case, $35. And we had a deal going on in the PC World shop, which is also affiliated with. We have both a software store and a shop that are affiliated with us. $23, excuse me, for an OEM license for either Windows 10 or 11, so you could pick your poison. And that came out to $553. And before people say, like, that's not $500, you can actually bring it down to $500, which is why I feel like I can say that accurately.
Oh, pooey. And I will say, my first thought before I looked at it was like, there's no way there's a Windows key in here that, you know. We've had debated in the past of like, does a Windows key include? But you did include one.
I cross my T's and I dot my I's.
I dig that.
I even have, not as a line item, but I even have options for a mouse and a keyboard, because some people are like, it doesn't include a mouse and keyboard. How are you going to compare that to a console? Yeah. It includes the controller. And I'm like, fine. Here, $28. $28, you get a budget mouse and you get a budget mechanical keyboard. Peace.
Also, I will say that I actually have built recently in that G300A. For a video that Willis is editing right now. I was like, this is actually pretty damn good quality for that price. I was just like, dang. I assume most $35 cases are just, you know, like gonna blow in the wind. This was not a bad case. So
it's a good looking case for that price.
Go ahead.
I was just saying it's a fantastic looking case for that price. I mean, especially if you compare it with the case you picked last year. I mean, obviously it's all subjective, but it's looks nice.
Yeah.
That is the one problem with these builds, right? So again, like the criticism that these builds will get from people is that they say like, you know, there's actually not good deals during Black Friday, because the part I want is not on sale. And that's true. If you have like really specific things you're looking for, it's not always a given that you'll find it on sale during Black Friday / Cyber Monday period. Sometimes you'll get better deals during the other parts of the year. Absolutely true. The point of these builds is that if you are starting completely from scratch, right, you can build a pretty decent PC with these builds for a lot less than the rest of the year. The downside is that you don't always get to choose how things look. And so this year, the PC hardware deal gods have been kind, and they were like, the Fantex case is on sale for an amazing price and you get a good looking build. Last year, maybe not to everyone's taste. There was one year I picked one and I actually put a little note, because I have like build notes, and like I added a little note that said, yes, this is $10 more than the absolute cheapest case I could have chosen, but I do have aesthetic standards.
Speaking of aesthetics, I did drop the image of the case, if you don't mind throwing that on screen and put it in Slack. I will note that this is the single fan version. There is a G300A with three fans, but it costs more. But that one single fan is RGB, so
it is. Yeah, it is. Right. So, going through this list, I'll just kind of finish up a summary of the build notes, which is, you know, like this is pretty great because the motherboard supports RGB and ARGB fans. So if you want to expand on the road and get blingy, you can.
It's a pretty good looking motherboard too. Nice little design aesthetic.
You have plenty of expansion slots. So if you are a person that ends up wanting to add a sound card or, you know, a capture card, there's the option there for you. You still can add even more RAM. RAM is super cheap, right? So like it was $35 for 16 gigs and you could have gotten 32 for like $55. So if you wanted to upgrade, that was not a problem. The SSD was high performing. You get onboard Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. So if you're not next to your router, absolutely easy to, you know, navigate. So that you can kind of scale up if you wanted to really easily, but you can also scale it down if you wanted to. So last year's 500 build had a Ryzen 5 5500 in there. Mm-hmm. I went with the 5600 this year, just because the prices were so close this year. And I liked the idea of having PCIe 4 support for this build. Again, mm-hmm. so it makes it a little bit more robust mm-hmm. for the long term. But you could like cut it down. So you could drop to a motherboard that only support like a B450 board. So, and the 5500, so you're really only getting PCIe 3. You could, you know, go with Linux instead of Windows. So you could make this a $500 PC. Like, you absolutely can.
Also, I'm surprised because this does have Wi-Fi, right? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Which yeah. I feel like that's a damn good bonus for this price.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So even if you drop down to the B450 motherboard I found, mm-hmm. also had Wi-Fi. So again, it's a nice build, I think, for 500. The only thing is like, I feel like this is a reflection of where we're at with like innovation and like companies basically slowing down, really pushing like, you know, really big hard upper upgrades because like the list is pretty much the same as last year, right? So, you know, some little upgrades here and there, but we're not seeing like, oh, you can get like a 7600 for like an insane price. Oh, like AM5 motherboards have come down a lot in price. Not seeing that quite yet. So I do feel like we're seeing some, I don't know if stagnation is the right word. It might be a little too strong, but we did see some slowing.
Hmm.
And this is a reflection of that.
Well, if there's anyone that feels a little iffy about going ARC, what would be the alternative?
Yeah, so there were sales on the RX 6600, which is the card I chose last year.
Mm.
The reason why I didn't pick it because it's $20 more expensive and no free games this year, which I thought was kind of unusual. AMD often really likes to go with like game bundles as an incentive. Like last year you could get like 3 free games with the RX 6600, if I remember right. It was at least 2. It was possibly 3. But nope, not this year. But I did put it in my notes where it's like, hey, like, here are some suggested upgrades. Like, you could put not use stock cooler, get an actual, like, third-party cooler for that that's a little beefier. You could upgrade to 32 gigs of RAM if you're like me and you love your browser tabs and multiple browsers. You know, I said, like, side-grade your graphics card, basically. Get a 6600 if you know, Intel's drivers have been improving, but if you want more of a more seasoned, mature kind of driver environment, then, you know, then your Radeon card is going to be your better bet there. And then also the power supply I mentioned, like you could upgrade that as well if you want something a little bit fancier, modular, that kind of thing. So all in all, very solid like fundamentals in this build.
Well, also, I do feel like if somebody was going to take the guts of this and be like, actually, you know what, I'm going to spend a little bit more on a GPU to try to step that up, that mm-hmm. 50, like, I don't feel like there's anywhere, me personally, that there's like a serious bottleneck. I mean, that 6-core Ryzen PCIe 4, like the motherboard, I'm sure, you know, will perform like, yeah. So if you were gonna like say step up to like a 6700 XT or something like that, like I don't think that what you have in there is gonna hold it back.
Funny that you mentioned that.
Yes. Why?
Thanks for just like tossing me these T-balls, basically. So there was also, you could upgrade and you could basically have a $700 1440p.
Oh, let's show the $700 version then.
Yeah. So basically very similar parts list, same 5600 CPU, B550 motherboard, still kept with 16 gigs of RAM just because most people who are gaming don't really need more than that. Then we jumped up, and I, for Cyber Monday, so for Black Friday, there was a card that was available for, I think, the XFX card,
mm-hmm.
like one of their, was it Spec Merc cards? I forgot the name of it.
Okay.
For $300, and that was a nice card, mm-hmm. nice shroud, well-loved.
Yeah.
That went out of stock, so for Cyber Monday, I had an option of doing an Asus card, I think, or an ASRock card, but I didn't really like the looks. And so here again, you could have saved $10, but my aesthetics ruined that, because I was like, you know what's really nice that Brad's always talking up? The Sapphire cards. And so there's a Sapphire Pulse Radeon RX 6700 XT for $310. And I was like, you know what? What's $10 for being able to enjoy looking at this?
And I do like the look of that card. We actually have, we do have that version. Oh, no, it's a 6750 XT. But yeah, I mean, it's a good looking card.
Yeah. And then I upgraded the PSU just a little bit. Probably still not super high in the tier list. So if people really buy into the tier list thing, like, you're obviously going to want to change that out. But that one has a little more wattage. That also is semi-modular, so it makes the build probably a little easier, cleaner to do. Storage, the Solidim P41, I upgraded to a 1 terabyte drive because, I mean, let's be frank here, like, 500 goes really fast.
If you're building
a PC on a budget, then 500 will get you through if you're just mostly playing games on it.
Yeah.
But for this, I'm like, you know what? You're playing at 1440p. You're already spending more money. Like, what's another $25 for another, you know, for some more storage? So upgraded that. Same case, same Windows license. It comes out to $727. And this one doesn't require any mail-in rebates, which is nice. The only two caveats I forgot to mention for both of these builds is that it is possible you will have to flash the BIOS so that it'll support the Ryzen 5000 part.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on which BIOS version the board ships with which is something I can't tell easily from the listing. But again, I put a note in there. It's like, you ask for a boot kit from AMD, so it'll delay your build and using it, but it's like, not impossible. You could also, if you live near Micro Center, I think they'll help you flash the motherboard so you can get, you know, going with your build. But yeah, it's a pretty solid build. The one that I wanted so badly, and I was like, oh, it's probably good that I don't live near a Micro Center, because just on principle, I might have shown my butt up at that door just to buy it. I'm like, Lane, you don't need another PC. How many PCs do you have floating in your house? How many PC part piles do you have in your house? I would have gone anyway, because Micro Center had this $300 bundle where you got the 5600 X3D.
Ooh, the 3D version.
With a Asus TUF B550 Wi-Fi motherboard and 16 gigs of DDR3200 RAM, which, you know, like, more ideally you want 3600 for that sweet spot, but, you know, honestly, you're getting a 5600 X3D in this bundle. Ooh. I was so excited by this. And, you know, it can really help improve frame rates depending on the games you play. So like, that to me is an incredible step up. And that brings you to 768 for the overall build. But I mean,
stupid
Microsoft. Nice. Super nice.
Yeah.
I did put a note in there. I was like, yes, it is normal to envy people who live near a Micro Center so badly that it hurts.
Yeah. No, it happens.
But I mean, it's important to note, if you find a good deal on that 5600 X3D part, wherever you happen to be, you can slap it into either one of these builds. No problem, right?
Yeah.
If you want to swap out at some point. I think the 5600 X3D is still a Micro Center exclusive. Is that right? It's been a while since I looked.
Last I heard, but I'm not quite sure.
Boo.
Yeah.
Boo.
Well, I have a couple questions on this.
Yeah.
You glossed over it recently, but what do you think, what kind of detriment do you think would be to be like, oh, you know what, I found an 8 gig kit for cheaper. Do you think 8 to 16 is like really going to mess you up on either of these builds?
Or do you think
it's just a nice to have?
I actually think, I know that my browser tab usage is not typical, but even knowing that my browser tab usage is not typical, I don't really like to recommend 8 gigs to people anymore, because one, 16 has become so cheap, and two, even like estimating, like, let's chop my usage in half, right? So like, I average about maybe like 20 out of my 32, And I don't think I even have, I mean, I have a lot of tabs open, but it's like not as many as some people I know, even still, right? And so like on average, between the person who only ever has two tabs open at one time versus mm-hmm. the person who has like 150 tabs open or more at a time. Yeah, don't look at him. I know that's gonna, that's not good for your brain. I just feel like it's an easy recommendation to just average it out and say like, just get 16. You don't have to think about it ever again, most likely, you know. Maybe you spent another $15 more than you needed to, but because I don't know exactly how you're going to be using this PC now and down the road, this just saves some headache for you. You know what I mean? Because I don't think they're going to be like reflexively and obsessively hitting control shift escape to look at task manager and being like, what am I at right now? What's slowing down? I think this browser might need a reboot because it's just hanging onto memory. It doesn't need. Like, they're just going to be like, my computer's slow.
MC, do you think you can get away with 8 or is that just not doable for you?
How do I put this politely? Hell no. no, I would say like a year or two ago, recommending it for a more casual user, I would have been sort of wobbling on it. Now with the way that even Windows itself is wanting a lot more RAM than it used to, I would struggle to recommend less than 16 to anybody for any Windows-based system. But especially if you're going to be gaming and you're going to be doing just a little more than you would on a normal budget build. Yeah, go 16 all the way. Go for 32 if you can.
Okay, all right. Mm-hmm. The other question I have is that you don't have any SATA SSD options in here. Do you think somebody could save money and throw a SATA in there?
And
still be viable?
You know, honestly, the reason for that is that SSD sales were weird this year. Well, like they were kind of anticlimactic. Like they're honestly disappointing because if you look at the price history, like they started dipping, like and they kind of hit their low point around like September, October, and then it's like started ticking back up.
Well,
and I was actually mildly offended by this because I'm like, that's not a deal. Are you kidding me? This is cheaper during freaking Prime Day in October.
Yeah, don't offend Alaina. Putting
that,
come on.
I'm not putting that on my best SSD deal list. No, I refuse. Probably to the, I hope my bosses aren't listening because that probably was not the right strategy. But there were surprisingly very few SATA SSD, like 2.5-inch. And honestly, these days, I don't even bother really looking at the M.2 versions of it. To me, it's either you get SATA SSD in 2.5 form factor, sorry, 2.5-inch form factor, or you're just going NVMe because of the price. Oh, sorry. That is my alarm. That does not apply anymore because unfortunately, why are you not? Stop. Hi.
Well, same thing. What about the ghost in the machine, same thing for spinning platter. Are we talking about like you can't save there at all? I mean, I'm not saying I'd recommend
you
it.
You can. I feel like at this point most people are just going to go with SSDs, so I didn't really pay as much attention to spending a lot of time with hard disk drives. As always, if you wanted to expand your storage, you could add like a bigger hard disk drive to your system, but it's not even worth it because like booting off a hard disk drive after it's painful. It's not worth it. It's just painful. So yeah, if there had been better SATA SSD deals, and I've done this in the past, I will use that as the primary boot drive. But honestly, the deals were so good, like $26 for a Gen 4 NVMe SSD. Like I'll take that. I think the benefit. Yeah,
you said even with the harder to find deals, you managed to go from a Gen 3 to a Gen 4 on your more expensive build and still save money. So yeah, it's still making progress.
Wait, for this year versus last year or this year to this year?
Yeah, I'm looking at your $800 build last year and it had a Gen 3.
Yeah, yeah.
And you went up to a Gen 4 and it's less than half the price. For the same storage. Fantastic.
Yeah, so I mean, the SSD pricing has gotten better in general, right, over the last year. But the frog in boiling water, you know, doesn't notice temperature change kind of thing, which, you know, maybe is not the right idiom here because it's not like things have gotten worse, but it's just more like, the temperature changed. I don't care about last year anymore. What's the relative deal percentage discount for this year.
Yeah, it's probably
was the last month better. Yes, I'm not featuring this in my build. I am offended by this.
No, I like this that you have morals when you come to this. So you're like, you know what? It's got to look a certain way. You know, I'm not going to do anything just to really cheap out. It's got to be of a certain quality. I appreciate that. So I will note that this motherboard does not have any sort of heatsink included for the Gen 4 drive. Do you think that's a concern?
Preface this with the fact that I live in a fairly temperate climate. I don't think it's that much of an issue, but I could see that if you live somewhere where like your ambient temps are kind of high, or you know, you don't upgrade with more fans in the system, like potentially it could be not what you feel is ideal. Like, I think most of the SSDs will be fine, but if you think it could be a concern, getting a heatsink or like a thermal pad or something is really usually not too big of a deal.
Okay. Yeah. Just asking. Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, for gaming, I mean, I would say it also depends on what you do. You know, if you're throwing a lot of files around, you know, and heating that drive up, yeah. But for gaming, I mean, I think probably if it's just mostly a gaming build, like probably the time it's going to get the warmest is like downloading or like decompressing or something like that. But yeah, I think it's fine. These are damn good builds. Yeah. But what if Alaina, man, I only have so much money. You're talking about a $700 build here. I only got half that in my pocket, or a little less than half that. What if I just only had $350 to my name?
Yeah. So. A part of me can't entirely give up the idea of like what's the cheapest decent now the asterisk of a decent gaming build. Like, I could have just stopped at the seven, like I do 500 then 700, and I was like, no, but I want to know, like, what's the lowest I can go.
Alaina has to know. She's got to know.
I know. Every year I tell Brad, I'm like, maybe I'll just do one this year. Maybe I'll just do one and like I'll just like sleep in a turkey coma and it'll be fine. And he's like, I think that's a great idea. Like, he means it. It's not sarcastic. Like, he's like, no, I think that's a great idea. I think you should enjoy your holiday. And I come back and I'm like, I have five. and so this year I was like,
even when you say that, Brad's like, okay, yeah, doesn't surprise me.
And so this year I'm like, no, I'm going to be good. I'm going to reduce it. And I'm like, I have three this year. I'm better. So the APU build, I guess that's kind of the tradition now. I feel like this is kind of the shape that I'm seeing, right, to it, where it's like, okay, so we have a system at 500, around 700. Last year was 800, so we did do better, as Mike points out. And then this APU is usually around the $300 range, and it's gotten better, right? One year it was so bad, and that was like a really big commentary on the state of things in the pandemic. I think I had it drop down to an Athlon, like 300G or whatever. I forgot the name of it now. No. Poor thing. It got me through. But, you know, this year's $350 build, Fortnite PC, 720p gaming, basically, 5600G. The B450 motherboard I mentioned earlier, I still put 16 gigs of RAM in there because why not? It's $35. You're still going to be using this like for probably like at least browsing the internet. So, you know, if you love tabs, go for it. The 500 gig MSI SSD that I mentioned, the $500 build. I did go with that 500 watt thermal take PSU that I mentioned earlier, because I was like, let's shave off $5 from the price. I mean, it's integrated graphics. If you're in this tight of a budget, most likely you're going to be buying used in the future if you're going to get a discrete graphics card, or you're going to be looking at the lower end anyway. So you probably won't need that much power, but you know, you always could upgrade if you really wanted to, which I mentioned in the notes. Again, the Fantex case, a Windows license, because I'm not going to cheat. I'm not going to cheat. $352. So if you wanted to get it closer to 300, just forego Windows, I guess. But it's a really solid little build.
It is.
If you want to play like esports titles at 720p, or honestly, if you just want a really nice little productivity PC, you know, You just need something to get on the internet with. Yeah. It'll last you a long time.
Well, earlier when we were talking about the Ryzen 8000G stuff, there were people in the chat being like, oh, this could be like a media streaming box or something like that. Mm-hmm, so, you know, there's definitely options. I will say I personally know some people who have budget builds that do not activate Windows and they just deal with the...
I did not hear that. I didn't hear any of that because I'm doing it all... I made Brad laugh 1 year because I used the phrase, I think, above board. I'm not sure why he thought that was funny, but he
above board. Said yeah, I feel like that's one of those things Gordon would stop and be like, what does that even mean, above board? Like, where does that phrase come from? I don't know.
Well, if you want to turn this into the PC World language podcast, yeah, I'm very down for that. People on Discord know how much I talk up having access to the Oxford English Dictionary to the San Francisco Public Library. I love my public library.
The micro ATX board, I guess it doesn't surprise me. But what do people generally lose going from micro AT or from full ATX to micro ATX? Is it just the extra slot?
Pretty much PCIe slot.
Does this all have all the same headers? I'm just looking.
Yeah,
real quick.
It also it doesn't have the same headers, but it does support RGB.
Oh,
if
yeah,
I remember
yep,
right.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, like, we've come a long way.
Yeah,
like that's another commentary,
it's
right? Where it's
headers.
Like. You can get a $6 motherboard, and yeah, you actually can plug in RGB fans into it if you want to.
Yeah, no, case fan headers. Yeah, no, I mean, it's got options. Okay. And Wi-Fi, right? No. Well, I see antenna slots for Wi-Fi. Does it not have
it
the
Wi-Fi? It does have
Wi-Fi. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's a good... These are really solid builds. The major criticism anyone could have of them is just that they're kind of old. In terms of like generation, right? Like it's not, you're not getting a current gen CPU. You're not getting a current gen GPU. And those are going to be the two biggest criticisms people would have of it, right? Because
yeah,
people always find something to nitpick. And that's going to be the big one. That's the big caveat for that. Yeah.
Though I will say, obviously around here, we're excited about the newest and shiniest thing, but a lot of times it's actually more beneficial to somebody getting an older system because it's more stable. It's more reliable. You know what to expect. Like, I feel like there is, like, sure, it's not the shiniest thing, but sometimes there is something to be said about, like, hey, you know what? It's been out for a couple of years. This thing's solid. You know what it is. There's less, typically less headaches that you have to deal with. I will say also, a friend of the show, Jester the Pester, gave us a $5 super chat. Thank you so much. Said, talking about anything on the internet, there is always at least one person that'll tell you that you're wrong. So, yeah, Alaina, don't worry. Don't worry. No
I'm
matter
not
what you
about
do.
It.
Yeah.
I'm not worried about it. I got the biggest compliment last year because somebody that I know through real life, basically you saw my article because I shared on Facebook, you know, I'm just like, just get like three more clicks for our website. Come on, help me out, friends. Just look at it for me. Just drive it for traffic. I'm not expecting anybody to actually build it, but one of the people I know in real life actually, they sent me a picture a couple of weeks later and they're like, my PC's already. And I was like, did you build based on my recommendation? He's like, yeah, it was great. I was like, oh, amazing. Nice. And he used it like as a template. Like, so you can get some swaps like a little bit here and there. But I was like, oh, somebody actually used my work. I love it. Made me so happy.
Well, so I know you only do this kind of bust out thing at you know, Black Friday, Cyber Monday timeframe. But I think it would be kind of fun every once in a while during the year to do one of these and maybe even like do it or use it as like a live build. Yeah, or something like that. You know what I mean? Like, I do like that idea of actually buying this, actually implementing it, and saying like, "Okay, here's what it was like." I think it's fun, but you know, I mean, what Amazon had like 3 Prime Days this year or something like that. I you know, like, not
I
that you need to do
different.
It each time. I'm just saying, you know.
I thought you meant actually trying to like so November and May. Right. So in May, we try to see what you can do for 500 and 700 and 350 and then use that as a comparison because that's also. Really
Yeah. Like, oh, hey, earlier this year, I was only able to get this. Yeah. No, I mean, either way, I like these ideas. We've done these kind of things even on the show, like, you know, just like thought processes of like, OK, well, you know, what do you get for this? But I do think there is a benefit to taking it a step further and actually building it and actually, you know, trying to run some tests on it because like it really is beneficial, I think, to a lot of people to kind of see it play out. So, cool. I dig it. Good write-ups. Thank you for the peek behind the scenes too, where your head was at with a lot of these things, because it is a very tight, succinct article, but I do also like hearing your the backstory and you know, and kind of your thinking thought process and all of this. So
conversations I had with Brad where he's like, will you just please take your holiday?
You're like, this is my holiday,
I must find a good deal.
Yeah. I like it. Okay. Let's move over to viewer Q&A, shall we? If you have any questions in the chat right now, or you know, something that you want to comment on, even get them in the chat at PC World. That's kind of the easiest way for us to see it. If you're watching or listening to this later, there's a link in the description to our Full Nerd Discord, awesome group over there. There is also a channel where you can drop questions in there, and hopefully I will get to them in the show. The first question, well, I guess it's a comment. It is a question from a friend of the show, Mike Quinton, gave us a $20 super chat. Thank you so much. Very appreciated. And says, for the SSD, does QLC versus TLC matter anymore?
I feel so bad because I feel like I am not qualified enough to, because I've been trying to keep up with this, but I'm like probably out of the loop again because it's shifted, you know, like the opinions on this. And so my answer is that I don't have an answer because I don't feel informed enough to give one.
To be fair. Yeah. No, I mean, usually Gordon is kind of the one with the deeper knowledge around that. Mike, do you have any opinions?
I'm going to bow out as well, because I'm running Gen 3 drives in my desktop, and I feel that's more than fine for me. So, yeah, I think if you need that much speed, you know what you need. And
yeah, I mean, there are easy shorthands for both, but also I would say it really depends on what you're doing, once again. Like I mean, we were also talking about, like, hey, if you get a SATA SSD, that's just fine for gaming. Like, sure, maybe the download speed, or, you know, like actual downloading the games or transferring them over, or maybe initial launch is a little slower than a NVMe SSD. Yeah. I think that's different, but also like QLC versus TLC, like it depends on what you're doing with it. If you're just gaming, like I don't think practically most people would not really notice the difference. And I think that's kind of who you're building.
Gordon's in the chat.
Oh, he is. Oh,
while Gordon appears.
Hello, Gordon. He likes to point out he bought a TLC 4 terabyte drive on a Black Friday deal. What was it, 2 years ago?
I think it was this year, because he was tweeting at me, Xing at me, posting at me. I don't know what you call it anymore. Yeah. He was tweeting at me. He's like, do I pull the trigger now? And I'm like, Gordon. He's like, well, I regret it. I'm like, Gordon, I love you, man, but I feel like no matter what you do, you're going to regret it. I've known you long enough now. Also, hi, Gordon.
Yeah, hello, Gordon. He said it was this year. Did you end up putting it in anything? Maybe I'm thinking when he got the SATA SSD for cheaper a couple years ago.
Well, there's an SD card that he bought.
Oh, that's what it was.
A few years ago. There was that. For sure. I remember that one.
Slam HK says, Gordon's just appearing in the chat to flex. Yes. You should know Gordon. Yes.
Yes.
He says it's a WD drive. Thank you for that super chat. Sorry we are not able to give you a real deep understanding of it.
Yeah.
But
thank you for the super chat.
Yeah. I appreciate that. Let me go over to the fine folks on Discord. We have some questions over there.
While you do that, Gordon has weighed in with his opinion, which is that TLC is fine for secondary bulk drives. So I think that's why he went with a TLC drive.
Mm, okay.
I think he's looking to replace his primary drive. I remember that from the conversation.
Okay. Real quick, we covered this last week, but I want to get MC's take. Starscream has asked us about favorite pie. MC, what's your favorite pie? I mean, it was in context to Thanksgiving, but you know, whatever, you can say whenever.
Off the top of my head, I got to go with a pecan pie, Southern boy.
Mm, yeah,
nice. Very nice. Okay, I dig it. I dig it. Sorry, had to throw that one in there. This was a question that Liquid R had posted when we had last week with Alex on, but it's a little more of a gaming thing that I think we can all touch on. They asked, what should Sony/Naughty Dog have called The Last of Us Part 2 Remaster to not raise the ire of gamers, or were we always going to ride the outrage pony over it? If you don't know, Naughty Dog announced The Last of Us Part 2, which, I mean, it didn't come out that long ago, but they're calling it a remaster. But really, to a certain degree, some people are claiming that it's more of a port to PS5 rather than a true remaster of a game that only came out a couple years ago. But yeah, I've heard both sides, and I think both sides are, you know, valid. But yeah, you answered your own question there. Were we always going to ride the outrage pony? Yes, you were always going to ride the outrage pony.
I hope I'm not looking at the stream. I hope we're flashing to Willis's sweatshirt right now as we talk about the outrage pony.
MC, are you a Last of Us fan? Have you played Part 2?
I don't really play horror games of any kind, but I agree. There's really no move you can make, especially with games that have this high a profile, that won't upset somebody. I'd say a game less than 2 years ago, call it like an Ultimate Edition or something. But does it really matter? Especially when it comes to Sony with their exclusives, they want to get as many editions of these games out as they can. That's just the way they roll. And some people don't like it, obviously, but it keeps making money, so who really cares?
I mean, I think the larger context too is like, oh crap, the TV show did really well for us. What if we put out something?
Part of it, yeah.
You know, we're not ready with Last of Us Part 3, so why don't we just re-release Part 2, call it a remaster, and you know, who knows?
I
don't know, but yeah, it's, you know, seems to be a little bit more of a marketing thing.
Got some intense pie conversation.
Oh, good.
In chat right now.
I love intense pies. Intense pies
so
are my
while
favorite.
You're looking for your next question, I'm going to throw a rando one.
Go for
here.
It.
Do you consider cheesecake pie?
Can I put it in my mouth? Yes.
Good answer.
You know what?
Adam subscribes to the 2-year-old methodology in screaming.
Can I put something in my mouth? Do you want to call it pie, cake? I don't care. Just, you know, sure. I am not, it is not going to impede any of my thought of having it enter my mouth.
Falcon Northwest.
Yes.
Is that Kilt over there?
Yes.
Hello. I think that's a good suggestion. We should put it in a poll as a poll. In the chat.
Oh yeah, is cheesecake a pie?
All right,
is that the go for it. So we have a question from friend of the show Ivan Ramazanov. One of these days I'm gonna get it right. Considering tiles are the future of chips, can we retire x86 by isolating all legacy stuff on separate parkable chip? I did read this earlier and I was like, huh, well, that's good. This is a good question for Ian. I'm gonna see him next week. Yeah. Maybe we'll do a video on this. All interesting stuff will run on the tiles with new instructions, like RISC-V, or is x86 still good enough to serve us for another 45 years? That is a really good, it broke my mind when I first read it, and it's breaking my mind again, but like the idea of like a disaggregated tile architecture where, you know, you've got the NPU, the CPU, the GPU, you know, all this kind of stuff on there. And then there's one tile that's, you know, like, hey, you know what? We can run the legacy x86 stuff, but really it's mostly based around a new instruction. That's, it'd be interesting. I don't know. I don't know if you can pull that off. But yeah, it's a good thought process.
That's a question to be answered by someone way smarter than me.
Yeah.
Definitely nominate Ian for the role.
Yeah. Also going on next week, there's an AMD AI event. Ian's going to be in town. I believe Wendell's going to be in town. I just got news last night from Jeff over at Craft Computing. Not only is he going to be in town for the AI thing, he is also going to come into the studio next Tuesday to join us for the next episode. So, expect some beer to be on the next show, and then also I'm doing his. He asked me to guest on his podcast next Wednesday. He's looking to do it at a live from a brewery. So, I'm oh, totally
very
down.
Nice. Very on brand.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe I'll ask him. Good question. Good question. We just got a super chat in from birthday boy Matthew Lang.
Happy birthday.
Food related.
I love it.
Okay, we're devolving into food already. Well, okay, we did it before.
You act like that's a bad thing.
I know. I just.
Thirty here.
Why is bacon called bacon and cookies called cookies when you bake cookies and cook bacon?
Oh,
that's a good one. That's like park in a driveway and drive in a parkway. That's yeah, funny. I never heard this.
I'm gonna actually dig into the OED. I think maybe later today.
Yeah, can you bake bacon?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Actually,
yeah, absolutely.
Prepare it. Oh, okay.
Yeah. People. Yeah. A couple of my friends actually prefer that method.
Oh.
Can
you cook cookies really, then?
I mean, yes.
I think you can actually. Like, you can actually. Like, I think you may be able to do it in like one of those like cast iron pans. Like, I feel like I see them do all kinds of random stuff in there.
Beep. I do. One of my goals, like we're talking about on the just behind the scenes, we're talking about doing some upgrading to audio equipment in the studio next year. And one of the things that I would love to do is wire up a button right here on the desk that you can just hit for like sensor bleeping.
Just your soundboard.
Yeah, just to have a button.
Well,
maybe I'd be
easy. We talked about before Gordon soundboard.
Oh like yeah, Gordon yeah, the Gordon. Yeah, but it was either Flash based or maybe Java based or something. So I actually don't think it's up anymore.
If the Zoo Crew in the morning can handle it, I'm sure you guys can rig it up. Come on.
I'm sure we can do it. The question isn't can we do it. Question is, should we do it?
Why is that even a question?
Because I might abuse. I have been known to abuse things.
Dr. Ian Malcolm would be very proud of you.
Yeah. So the last question I have for birthday boys, $10 super chat is, what's the difference between baking and cookies? Baking and cooking. Baking is in an oven. Cooking is on a stovetop. Is that the definition?
I mean, generally, yes. Mm-hmm.
I tend to think of baking has to do with more of like there's some kind of bread element in it. There's a little bit of chemistry in it more than just heating stuff up.
Well, you just said baking, you can bake bacon.
Yeah, but that's a very specific method to avoid having to fry it.
Okay, I have a definition from Merriam-Webster.
Please.
The first definition as a transitive verb is to cook by dry heat, especially in an oven. Or a second definition is to dry or harden by subjecting to heat.
As in like a brick, okay.
I mean, sometimes if you don't watch your bread, that's what it becomes, my friend. That's what it becomes.
Okay.
And then cook, let's see, here we go. I can type. Verb is a transitive verb, is to prepare food for eating by a heating process. It sounds like their definition is more that there's like that element of like a dry heat or to like remove moisture, as opposed to like cooking doesn't necessarily involve that, right? Because you can add oil, like that kind of stuff to the process. So I think, and then colloquially, we associate cooking with a stovetop situation and then baking with an oven type situation.
Clear as mud.
Now I'm just trying to see if I can just use
pie.
Cookie batter and then just put it on a cast iron with a little bit of oil and then just flip it like a flapjack, like pancakes.
I'd eat it.
Yeah, right?
I'd eat it. Okay, I'm totally down.
Matthew Lang is commenting on our commentary and it's fantastic. You should read that out loud.
And Eric says all my favorite verbs are transitive. What the hell does that mean? What does transitive verb mean, please? That when you said that too, I was like, I have no idea what she just said.
Transitive verb takes an object. An intransitive verb does not require taking an object. I think I've got that straight. One of them is one and the other is other. Let me just verify. I'm getting really hungry, so.
Bacon pancakes.
So our object here would be cook. And if you cook, you're a cook. You are cooking it. So.
There we go.
As long as it's edible.
Merriam-Webster. A transitive verb is a verb that takes a direct object, which is a noun, pronoun, or noun phrase that follows the verb and completes the sentence's meaning by indicating the person or thing that receives the action of the verb. The direct object typically answers the question what or whom. For example, the kids like pickles. That really annoys me. Have they sold their house yet? An intransitive verb is not used with a direct object. Nailed it. If something comes after an intransitive verb, that is, in the position inhabited by a direct object, it doesn't answer what, whom. It instead answers a question like where, when, how, or how long. Her car died suddenly last week. Someone was coughing loudly. A single verb can have both transitive and intransitive uses, like they are playing soccer, they've been playing all afternoon. So that's the basics of it. You can keep reading more. There's more.
Alaina,
this is the kind of stuff that I went to school for.
Can you use it in a sentence with an RX 580?
Oh boy.
I bought an RX 580.
Oh, okay. That's a transitive verb. Okay, sure. There you go.
Returning to the baking Please. And cooking question, though, I want to highlight Falcon Northwest's question, which is, so do graphics cards bake, fry, or cook?
Okay, are you removing moisture from a graphics card? Oh, there is moisture in the vapor chamber. So
I mean, you know. I think technically it would be baking because it is basically just like getting so intense that it's dry. But frying has a colloquial meaning to it, which is why we often
frying
refer
means
to
oil, things. Right? In my mind,
generally.
Typically, however, it is because it has a connotation of like you get so heated or like you get so. Have so much heat applied that you basically get the effect of having fried something because it's a very hot kind of cooking, right? Mm-hmm. That's basically what frying is. And so I think colloquially, it's kind of like moved its way back so that even now Merriam-Webster has an official definition of fry, third definition for it as a transitive verb, to damage or destroy an electrical device or circuitry by overheating, especially as a result of an unusually high voltage.
Oh, okay. So they added that third definition for electronics?
Merriam-Webster is more of a progressive dictionary. Yeah. So like as things start entering common usage, they'll eventually like enshrine it officially in the dictionaries.
Okay. I dig it. I mean, that makes sense. Yeah. Like I fried my GPU. I mean, I hear somebody say, oh, I cooked my GPU. I don't think I could hear anybody being like, oh man, I baked my GPU.
Yeah, because there's language is not always about being super precise or technical.
I mean, have you heard me?
It's about being poetic, right? Or like a little bit more fancy. Like, you know, just have a little flourish on it. Like how if you sign your name, you just put like a little thing as opposed to just being like perfect cursive, right? So... language is not okay. It can have some artistry to it.
No, I think if we're talking like actual literal food prep as far as computers are concerned, obviously you fry either on the GPU or directly on the CPU without the cooler, and then you use just the general space inside the case to bake. Multi-purpose, obviously.
It's like an instant pot, but
or just a really, really expensive, like easy bake oven.
Yeah, sorry. No, there's like this multi-use oven that Panasonic makes. That's kind of like that, actually. Yeah.
Also, is cheesecake one word or two words?
Oh, sorry, it's actually one word.
Well, okay, yeah.
No, I made a typo.
No, that's fine. Typos happen. Okay, two more questions. I guess we're just on the food thing, so let's just go to another one. Friend of the show, Liquid R. What's your favorite way to consume potatoes that are not Tech Tech potatoes?
Oh, dear.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? Maybe somebody should take a photo with Ian biting a chip. So it's like a human centipede of chips.
I wasn't gonna go that way. I was gonna actually say like chips, like a potatoception or something, but you had to make it weird.
Yeah, that's what I do.
you're telling me that if Ian is a walking, talking potato, edible to potato, he's wouldn't take a bite out of him.
He's literally a tech potato. I mean, he does. Yeah, I'll bring this up with him next week too. All right, potatoes, MC. How do you like them?
I like to bake potatoes. I like to bake red potatoes instead of the regular, what my grandma calls Irish potatoes.
Oh, fancy.
I'll take two of those, a little bit of oil, a little bit of salt, a little bit of pepper, put them in the oven for about 50 minutes, and that's it.
Butter, sour cream, putting chive, anything on it?
A little bit of butter, and then some of the spice mix that I've got, the California pepper plant that I have mentioned before. They have a spice rub, and I'll put a little bit on top of it.
Ooh, yes. All right, Alaina? Potatoes.
Oh man, it's so hard to choose. I love potatoes. I love starches. They're great. But honestly, I think my favorite is my dad's version of what do they call it? Home fries.
Thick ass fries.
Yeah. It's one of my favorites. Also, how he does hash browns. My dad's a good cook, so I pretty much like how he prepares all of his potato dishes.
Okay, I like it. Willis, potatoes.
All potatoes, man. All potatoes. I love potatoes.
Yes.
I mean, I'm the same way. Like,
it's hard to go wrong with potatoes.
Well, I was trying to think, is there any way I don't like potatoes? Is there anything you could literally do to a potato that I wouldn't eat?
Not cook it?
It's not good. I have tried that.
It's not terrible. Like, chop them up and make sure they're clean. A little bit of raw. It's got a nice, nice crunch to it. It's not that bad.
Yeah, it's got a snap. Like a, it tastes like dirt though.
Fermented.
That's my downside.
No, you eat the inside of it. You
okay,
don't
fermented.
Eat the
is that a real thing?
No. Well, okay. There's like Asian
sure
style potato salad
it.
That's in that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was about to say yes. Okay. In that potato. In that case, fermented. Yeah. Then I would not do it. Boiled, mashed, stick
boiled
in the
mashed.
Stew. Yeah. Okay, but do we love potatoes around here?
Potato
salad. And, maybe that's not a favorite for me.
Well, no, I reckon. And tech potato. That's who I voted for as my favorite potato.
There you go.
last question. We'll get out of here. Not food related, but also kind of fun. Friend of the show. Jester the Pester, whatever we're calling him now. if your friends or family held an intervention for you, what would be the reason? No need for a serious answer. Alaina, if your friends held an intervention for you, what would it be? We're getting serious here now. You can speak quietly into the microphone.
There's a lot of reasons why they would want to hold an intervention. That's the problem. How do I choose one?
Alaina, you're saving too much money. Spend your
money. No, it'd be more like, Alaina, you have 14 different red lipsticks already. Maybe you should just finally give up the search. Like, you're never gonna find that magical shade you're looking for. Yes, I can see that they're different. That one's an orange red, that one's a blue red, that one's a true red, but none of them are the one you want, so maybe you should just like quit while you're ahead.
Liquidar has a good one. Alaina, do you really need that many monitors?
Yeah, I do. You try testing on 4 different PCs and tell me how many monitors you need.
MC, what would people come talk to you about?
For the thing that I'm willing to admit in front of a live audience, it would probably be Legos, just high-end Lego sets.
I'm already to the point where
I cannot display
them. Do you need
them all.
That? Do you need another Lego set, Michael?
Yes, he does.
Objectively, no, I don't. I don't care. I feel like putting them together. Yes, it's worth $600 for this latest whatever they put up together. Obviously.
Obviously.
11,000 pieces.
Yeah. Alaina, did you finish your NES Lego set?
I don't want to talk about it, Adam. Okay. They're too painful to bring back these topics.
Mike, do you need another custom keyboard?
No, I just finished my latest one. I won't need one for 3 months.
To be fair, you get to review them. You know, you have a lot of keyboards because you're reviewing them. Wait, do you have a lot of keyboards because you review them, or do you review them because you have a lot of keyboards?
That's a chicken and egg question. There's no correct answer. But the true tragedy of my job is that as much as I love keyboards and as much time and money as I spend building my own, I almost never get to actually use them because I have to use everybody else's keyboards to tell you if they're good or not.
Okay. Here's a good one. I like this from The Vapors.
First world problems.
The Vapors, do you really need that many audio plugins? Do you really need that many plugins?
What about you?
It'd be like, Adam, do you need another handheld gaming device?
That's actually a really accurate one for you.
How many handheld devices are in that drawer? Oh boy. Okay.
That's actually super spot on for you.
Actually, I was
$350.
I was in a meeting yesterday. No joke. I was in a meeting yesterday, and somebody was like, "Oh, hey, have you heard of the Steam Deck thing?" And literally on my desk, I had three. I was like, "Nope, never
Maybe.
Heard of it." Three.
Baby.
Here, let me just juggle them in front of the camera for you.
Here we go. Willis.
So, do you need any more teas? So we my partner and I we buy a lot of teas as a collection.
T-shirts or tea
brewing tea
brewing tea
brewing
okay.
tea. So we buy a lot of tea everywhere we go. We bought a lot in Germany as well. So it's just like
Willis,
do you need more tea?
Willis, do you really need more tea? Are you gonna drink this tea before it goes?
We have a whole like half a shelf dedicated to just teas.
Nice. Okay. Well. But do you drink them?
Yes.
Okay.
But very slowly.
Very slowly.
I heard that as cheese.
Oh, cheese. Do you need more cheese?
Willis, do you need more cheese?
I was like, how can you not have enough? Like, how can you not want to buy a new cheese to try? Like, that's absolutely justifiable.
I will say, though, out of all the things that we've mentioned, well, I don't know. What's the average price for a lipstick, Alaina?
I mean, how much do you want to pay?
Alaina, what's the average price of a lipstick that you buy?
List price or what I actually pay?
Okay. Well, no. The question I'm really trying to answer is it more or less than buying tea?
More than buying tea, I would say, unless it's like really fancy rare tea.
So at least tea is the least like the thing that costs the least out of all the things that we mentioned.
I mean, they can cost up to about $13-$15 for 100 grams, though.
Weigh by the gram. Okay.
It adds up.
Things that make it sound like that Willis has a drug problem.
Yeah.
I'm glad I wasn't the one who said it.
Like, oh man,
they put them in a baggie, you know. So
okay. I gotta go to the tea store. Wait out by the cram.
You did wait for me when we were at LTX. You know, we went to Granville Island, and I went to this tea station.
We bought a bunch of tea. Yeah. No, I think you did that before we met up with you.
Yeah.
But yeah. No, you're right. I did. It was actually a cool little booth. Yeah. All right. One more question I saw coming here, just because it's a little topical. Call Dragonborn asks, any off the top thoughts about Frore Systems air jet cooling? It seems so cool for handhelds. Yes, and yes. If you didn't notice, we put up a video recently. We were able to go down to the Frore labs, or I guess offices down here in the Bay Area. So it's just quick little jump. I went there with Macworld's own Roman Loyola. Love Roman. Ooh. Talked about him, maybe getting him on the show sometime.
He's been
I love
on the
Roman.
Show before.
Yeah. So anyway, yes, I love anytime Frore has a new air jet thing to show off. Yes, handhelds are the thing that I'm like, when are you going to be putting this on a handheld? When are you going to be putting this on a handheld? they hear it. Not only do I say it, a lot of people say that in the comments as well. I think at this point where I'm at, though, like it has been fun, you know, starting to see this at CES earlier this year and kind of seeing the evolution of the... I like seeing that the engineering team is like constantly like, oh, okay, well, we have this air jet system, you know, how can we apply it to different electronic devices? But not only that, how can we actually introduce different ways of cooling with the air jet? Watch the video. I'm not going to spoil, or go into depth here. But I think also at this point, though, and, I kind of had told them they're like they need more products out. You know, they have that one Zotac mini PC, which is actually hard to get. Mm-hmm. I have heard that they are coming out. I do want to buy one. Some people in the our Discord were talking about they want to get one too. And I did ask Frore. They don't know. I mean, it's a Zotac product. But it sounds like they're busy filling B2B orders before they offer more consumer oriented orders. So hopefully
we'll
get our hands on it soon. But I mean, ultimately for me, it's like, I love going to see the demos, talking to the team, but they just need more. They need more out there. They need more devices, more actual official stuff out there. And I mean, they feel the same way too. But yeah, I want to see it in shipping products more. So cool stuff.
I think it's worth pointing out that the solid state cooling is so cool and such a huge leap forward. Obviously, we want to see it in more stuff, but it requires a whole new way of thinking about these products, like a For huge sure. jump as far as the engineering is concerned. We're talking like a shift from hard drives to solid state drives and how like they fit into everything that we build. That's the kind of thinking that we have to adjust for here. So it's going to take some time.
Oh, definitely. And it also depends on the industry too. I mean, one of the things they talked about loving working with Zotac is that they were able to, you know, work with the team and get out a product like that. Whereas I remember I was like, oh, hey, you know, you should reach out to Canon because they got cameras that overheat. That would be awesome. And then I was like, oh, wait, you want to talk about a company that's going to move at molasses pace? Canon is probably high up on that list. Like, yeah, even if they started working on it last year, you're not actually going to see it in a product till like 10 years from now. So, yeah, it's not just them. It's also Magnus just asked, have you tried scented thermal paste?
What kind of scent?
Hey, I will say, Willis made fun of me when I did a video, ROG Ally. I do like, one of the things I love doing is smelling a handheld. When I'm first using it, I like to just smell what that vent is coming out.
He whiffs it.
I do. Whiff. I'm not the only one.
Wait, is this the equivalent of a new car smell for you?
Yeah. And each of them have a different smell too. It's not just just generic electronics. There is a distinct smell to all the handhelds.
Wow, I really learned something new about one of my colleagues.
There's something about it. I like doing it. And now the idea of, could you actually have a scented thermal paste?
No.
I don't know if that exists, but you know what? You're right. Let's shut this off. I need to go hurry and mail this idea to myself so I can say I have the trademark.
Oh my God.
Here we go. If anyone wants to invest in my company of scented thermal paste, I will get in on that action. You can get a large cut of the enterprise. I don't know we need a catchy name. Any quick names off the top of the head? I'm not good at that. Alaina?
No, I'm bad at names. You want Brad on that case. Yeah. He's really good. Mm. But I'm laughing because I'm like, oh, Adam is the reason why we have Prop 65 warnings on everything. And then Davina in chat was like, they'll need a new California sticker warning.
Wait, I thought Prop 65 was for pregnant ladies. No, isn't
it? Oh, it's a notice to let you know that there are potential like hazardous materials in a product.
Oh,
basically, and the warning is that these are substances known to create problems for people who are vulnerable, like pregnant women. Mm-hmm. Which is on the sticker, I think.
Well, I guess never read the sticker. So
the sticker will just be Adam's silhouette just sniffing on anything, consoles and whatnot.
This guy, don't do what this guy's doing. Also, Magnus says Apple scented thermal paste exists in Japan.
What?
Okay. Oh. Yeah, I need to import this hot import item. Apple,
so
if you have a link, please email it to me. Or send it on Discord. Yes.
We might
go to Computex. You're just going to make a stop in Japan. You get your scented thermal paste.
There you go.
Okay. Okay. Last question. We'll get out of here. If you had a scented thermal paste, what would it be, Alaina?
Oh, no. Okay.
If you get to pick any
later. You got to come to me later because I don't think that well.
Okay.
Off the top
MC,
of my head for
MC, if there's a, is there a scent that you'd be like, that's what I want to smell when I turn my computer on?
When I buy the scents like for my house and the little plug-in things, I always get the laundry scented one. So I guess I go with that.
Oh, like
really
a
really weird
like,
coming out of my computer, but okay.
Like a clothes on a line, like
yeah,
that kind of fresh clothing scent. All right, Willis, if you could have a scent off top of your head,
cheesecake, obviously.
Cheesecake, yes, yeah. And would I call it a pie scent?
cheesecake/pie scent.
Yeah. Okay. And mine would be the scent of a Steam Deck. I want my tower to smell like a Steam Deck.
Wow. Yeah, no, I'm just kidding. Wow.
And what does a Steam Deck smell like, Adam?
You'll have to buy my thermal paste to see.
I think I would choose like almond, like an almond scent. Like the Jergens has this like cherry almond scent that like I really used to like. Or lemon scented. I'm a big fan of lemon scented kitchen soap. So okay. I think I could extend that to my PC as well.
No, maybe I'll put those on my first introductory line. Fresh scent, lemon scent. Cheesecake scent and Steam Deck scent. That's going to be
my
launch.
Suggested bacon. Lewis Law in chat suggested bacon.
Bacon.
Magic marker scent. Al Pacino scent. Scent of a Steam Deck.
Do you all remember those
fried chicken
scented markers that we had in like elementary school?
Oh yeah.
Those are pretty great.
Yeah. Yeah, and you could see just how far you could stick it up your nose without actually drawing it on your nose. Or maybe that was just me. Okay. We should wrap it up. Check back next week for your fix of PC talk here on the Full Nerd. To listen to us on the go, subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube Music, Pocket Cast, or wherever you can point this RSS feed to. If you are using one of those options, please rate and review us. I know that Pocket Cast actually just started allowing ratings of podcasts, so please get us over there. Anytime you do, my company introduces a new scented thermal paste, and we need more options out there for sure. I want to thank Alaina Yee for coming on the show. Alaina, thank you for coming on. Did you really need to come on the show?
I mean, didn't I?
Yeah, did you? I mean, you're collecting a lot of podcasts. Why don't you share it around? Just kidding. Michael Kreider, thank you for coming on the show. I appreciate it, especially last minute. Last minute, we called him up. I was like, hey, Mike.
Let's stop high.
Yeah. thank you, everybody, for watching. And thank you, Willis, for staying awake after your hot late Vegas nights.
Well, thank you, everyone, for tuning in. Definitely go get some pie, get some mashed potatoes. Not you know, all together at once, but, you know. Get the potato first and then the pie. All right, thank you everyone for tuning in. We'll see you next time. Bye.
a thermal paste scented thermal